Good afternoon and welcome. It is amazing. No, it's really not amazing. It is good to see so many of you here to support Carol and her family at this time. And if you didn't have a chance to see them last night, we understand, because about 800 other people beat you there. It's pretty amazing. Roger was greatly loved. Yes, widely known, but greatly loved. We all miss him. None of us will miss him like his family does, like his sisters do. But I know where he is. I stand here with the assurance of the Word of God that Roger is with his Creator, with his Savior, with his Lord, and in that we find comfort and hope. Scripture says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction, so that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For just as the sufferings of Christ are ours in abundance, so also our comfort is abundant through Christ." I would like to pray. Please bow with me. Lord, we're all still trying to process Roger's passing. For his family, it's still so soon. Lots of just wrestling with the reality of it. For all of us, we're just kind of confused by it, Lord, to be honest, why you would call someone who's just started retirement, by all appearances, very healthy and strong, and yet it was, as we know from Scripture, your time to call him home. And while we wrestle with that from our point of view, we know you are a good God. You are a faithful God. You are a loving God. You could have raised him up. Many of us were praying a week ago Friday fervently for that, but you called him home. So we're here to do two things. We're here to honor Roger's memory, and by doing that, biblically, correctly, in love, to comfort Carol and the family, and his sisters and their families. But also, knowing Roger as well as I did, I'm here to honor you, Jesus, his Savior, for the work of grace that you did in his life and how your work in his life has impacted so many other lives. So we need your help. I believe we have your presence already in this beautiful chapel. Comfort the family even as they share, as we hear Scripture, as we sing your praises, as we remember Roger, a man greatly loved by so many. We honor you, Jesus, his Lord and Savior, knowing he is there with you. To be absent with the body, Paul would write, is to be present with the Lord. And we do, as much as we miss him, rejoice in that wonderful fact. I pray this all in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. We're going to start with a song. There's going to be several songs here today, and these songs are especially meaningful to Carol. Most of you know Carol has been worship leader in this church, and then she's been a worship leader in our church, and we've been greatly blessed. Carol, you have ministered to us, so now we will make our attempt to minister back to you all. But these songs they're special in their content because while they are mostly contemporary music, they all proclaim the work of Christ and the hope that we have in Christ. So this song's called "I Will Rise." One.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul, I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise. When this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. From the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will. Of every angel sing, worthy is the Lamb, and I hear the cry of every longing heart, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the
I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees. I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. I will rise. Roger will rise. Amen. I'm going to share a brief outline of Roger's life. It's taken mostly from the obituary and some of my own memories. The family has prepared several things that they're going to share as well. If we had an open time for everyone to share, how long would we be here? Because if you know Roger, you knew Roger, you probably have a story. You would have more than one story. And after the service, we'll be going back to Shiloh Chapel and the fellowship hall and having a light luncheon together. And if you can come, it's a nice day. We may have to eat outside a little bit. That's okay. We can do that. But I would like to hear your stories. The family needs to hear your stories. Hearing stories about a loved one is a very healing thing. Roger was born August 31st, 1975. Huh? 57. One of my many spiritual gifts is dyslexia. Yeah, as soon as it came out, I went, he was amazing. Anyway, Lord help. Yeah, 57 works a lot better than 75. He was the youngest and only son and grew up with five sisters. They have stories. One's gone to be with the Lord, but they have stories. They wrote, those that knew Roger would describe him as a family man deeply rooted in his faith. That sentence is huge because it encompasses so much of the person of Roger Levesque. They would say there is nothing that he would not do for his family or friends at any hour of the day or night. If there was a need, he was there. And if you knew Roger, you were already part of his family. Roger was the true definition of what it means to be a great husband, father, brother, friend, but one more. Bumpa. His favorite role, I think. No offense to everybody else, but he loved the grands. He graduated from Lisbon High School and then shortly thereafter met the love of his life, Carol. And I love this. They were at a New Year's party where he snuck in a kiss and then he said he needed another one. And so they've been smooching ever since. Married April 24th, 1981. They raised their five children, but as many of you know, many more children were in and out of that house. And every one of them, at least from what I observed over the years, found love and care and support and faith. That combination is so huge and so missing in so many parts of our world today. Roger was a worker. He was a hard worker. He was a smart worker. I told him once to his face, I said, Roger, I don't like you. I did. As a pastor, you can say things like that. Nobody cares. Anyway, I said, Roger, I don't like you because you can do so many things, and I'm so envious. If I could do half the things you know how to do. But then Andrew says, he didn't do them all 100%, though, huh? Now, Andrew's got stories, so that will get balanced out in time. He started out at Bath Iron Works as a crane operator, worked his way up into management in the safety and health department. I remember him sharing a story with me as he went through the different rotations of his work. This was before his last job, before he left BIW. They had a major undertaking to do. They had a big piece of ship, because they had sectionals, and it wasn't going well, and something had moved, and they had a big safety meeting. How are we going to move this piece safely? And Roger told me, he said, this was a big deal, and we had one chance to do it right, or somebody could get really hurt, or worse. The whole thing could go down. So he said, before that meeting, we didn't really have a good plan, but he said, I went alone in another office, and I knelt down and I prayed to God, and I said, God, we've got to have an answer how to get this piece in place safely. And he said, within minutes or whatever it was, I had a plan. Back in, had the meeting, did the plan, everything went fine. And I thought, Roger was a clever guy, but he knew he wasn't clever enough for that one. So he found his Lord and Savior to give him the help that he needed. I love that story. He finished his career at Tex Tech, and he just retired last year, and he so loved retirement. So we're all grieving that it was cut so short. But he did enjoy life. I had the privilege, this is another reason why I didn't like him, I'll explain. Roger was an avid outdoorsman. He really was. And I had the chance to go fly fishing with him. And I really wish we had video capabilities here because I would love to show you Roger's fly cast. The whole trick with a fly, I have a lousy one, so why am I explaining it? But anyway, a fly cast, when the line finally feeds out, the speed slows way down so the fly just barely drops on the water, just like a bug landing on the water. Roger could do that. Mine, I scare fish away for miles. Slaps down. And I remember talking to Roger, and he coached me a little bit, but I enjoyed fishing with these guys, because I literally would. I'd sit in my canoe and just watch them and say, this is why they catch fish. There's actually a reason to this. But the other part of being outdoors with him was the time we spent indoors in the camp. And we had good fellowship, sharing, laughing. It was all good. It was good. He loved hunting. That's where he spent his last days, hunting with two of his Christian brothers. When God called him home, and it's still hard to take in, but he was out in the woods. He loved it. A question for you all. Did Roger like dogs? His family, I think, could answer that. He and Carol. He and Carol love dogs. No, they are not their grandbabies. They love them. They know the difference. They love their grandbabies. But he loved his dogs. He loved his family. And then in the obituary, there's a literally a six-word statement. I will read word for word because it's such a large statement. Roger was a man of faith. He was instrumental in the building of this church. He was very involved in ministries here. And then in God's time, when he and Carol came over to our church, by the way, some of you coming here may not know this. I'm not the pastor here. They wouldn't have me. But anyway, I was pastor. I'll get it straight. I'm retired now. I was pastor over at Shiloh Chapel in Durham. But Roger and Carol just lived down the road from us. And we had done music programs together. We'd done music programs here years back, the Laco Food Pantry, Lisbon Area Christian Outreach, we did ecumenical services every Thanksgiving. We had seven or eight churches that combined. We had good times. And that's where we got acquainted during doing these services. And then time, God brought them. I think it's so Carol could walk to church and do music. It was a good reason. But Roger was so involved. When they came to Shiloh, they became involved there as well. Carol with the music ministry, Roger became a deacon. But here was what I noticed in my relationship with Roger, and I bet many of you would say the same thing. Roger was always willing to take the time to listen. Listening is a lost art in our culture, I think. And I'm not going to sermonize on that one, but Roger could listen and really listen, because when you're listening for comprehension, you're noticing body language. You're listening to the sounds and voice inflection. Roger could do that. Roger would listen and then respond and then pray. And then he would encourage and challenge, especially other men, what it meant to be godly. We need more men of God like Roger. God called Roger home, but men, it's our turn, because Roger's left us an amazing legacy. His call to my heart, this is to my heart, and maybe it's to your heart too, is to be the man of God that God created you to be. No, you won't be in charge of cranes, probably at BIW and all of that. But wherever you are, I believe God wants us, those of us who call ourselves Christian, to be the kind of man and faith in both spiritual and practical terms that Roger was. He's left me a tremendous example. So for the next few minutes, we're going to have family members share. I'm going to start with Andrew. Andrew's going to present the eulogy today, and I am very grateful you are both willing and able to do that. I do. It's a great family. So Andrew, come on up.
Can you hear me now? Good. It's quite a testament to Dad to see so many people here. to see so many people here and the close to 800 people that were at the church yesterday. Some people were waiting 2.5 hours in line just to pay their respect. So thank you. There have been many people asking what happened to Dad. So Mom wanted me to touch on that real briefly so that it stops coming up, I guess. I don't know. So that everybody's aware, because everybody cared for Dad. So Dad was on his annual hunting trip up in Abbott with his friends Ed Blaisdell and Jim Howell. This camp is deep in the woods and outside of cell phone range. Dad wasn't feeling well the days before, and he ended up collapsing in the morning of Friday the 18th. His dear friend Ed was with him when this happened, and he had to make the very hard decision to leave Dad at the camp and head to his truck to drive out to a field to be able to call 911 to get the help to Dad that Ed just couldn't provide. Ultimately, Dad suffered a catastrophic hemorrhagic stroke, and he had two aneurysms that burst at the same time. He was rushed to the hospital in Dover Foxcroft, where after a CAT scan, two doctors had agreed that there was nothing that could be done to save Dad, so they told us that we needed to get up to the hospital so that we could say our goodbyes. We were fortunate that we could make it to the hospital in time. Throughout the day, he was surrounded by his wife, children, and siblings, and we were just loving on him and we were holding him. And at about 7:20 last night, or not, sorry, at 7:20 p.m., Dad took his last breath while Mom was holding on to him and saying that she loved him. So that's the story. So where do I begin to sum up the life of my dad? I know it started long before I came along, and so we'll just jump to the part where I enter the picture, because that's where his life was definitely improved. My dad was a great dad. He was the kind of dad that people wish that they would have. Many friends have commented over the years that they wish they would have had a dad as good as my dad was. And let's face it, if you were one of the friends of his kids, you were pretty much one of his kids. I see several people here today that Dad loved you like you were one of his own, which is amazing. And that's a true testament to who he was. He was a good man and a great father. A funny thing about Dad was that he was a crier. Any of you ever seen the TV show Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman? Yeah, we'd be watching the show and he'd be tearing up in the back, saying he was fine. Or our ASPCA commercials. He'd have to change the channel. But really, that's because he was such an emotionally connected person and he was empathetic through and through. He had a hard time seeing people struggle without him trying to make it better. When we were young, Mom and Dad struggled to make ends meet. And this was surprising to me because I didn't learn about it until I was in my 30s. That was because Dad sacrificed so much of himself to make sure that we were cared for. For a long time, he worked two jobs, almost 80 hours a week, so that Mom could stay home and raise us. He knew the value of his sacrifice and didn't think twice about it. Mom tells me the story of when Dad saw me take my first steps. Turns out I had actually been walking for a week, but he was working so much that he was so excited to see it, and Mom had a hard time breaking it to him that, yeah, it's been going on for a little bit. But really, he gave up so much for his kids, and I don't think I ever really thanked him for that. I'd like to think that he knew it without the words being said. I just figured we would have more time, but everybody does. So I'll cherish my childhood forever. I need to quote Erica here for a minute, because we refused to let her forget this, and this is one of our funnier stories from childhood. I'll set the stage. She was about 6 years old, laying on the couch, and she said, and I quote, I love my mom, and I love my dad. I love them both the same. But if I didn't, I wouldn't say anything because I wouldn't want to hurt Dad's feelings. Or Mom's. as funny as it was, Dad knew that she loved him. When we were young, Dad would play games with us older kids where he would sit on the floor with his back on the couch, and he would throw us up into the air out and away from him. How he didn't break an arm or a leg, I don't know. We'd also do another game where he was on the floor and we'd try and run past him and he'd grab onto us and tickle us. And as I stand here and I describe these games, some people are probably like, eh, so? To us as kids, they were amazing. The dad worked his long job for many hours and still made time for us at night because we were that important to him. Dad taught me many things, the best being was how to fly fish. I always looked forward to our Moosehead Lake camping trips, where he and I would sneak away for a little river therapy. On our last trip this past July, I stopped for a minute and I watched him. He was standing there, knee-deep in the Roach River, just flicking his line back and forth. I was overwhelmed with admiration and love for my dad standing there. I thought how lucky I was to have a strong, godly man leading us, leading our family through life. I took a picture of him. I remember thinking how much I cherished those fishing trips and knowing that life was so unpredictable, any trip could be our last. Little did I know, that would be the last time I got to go fishing with Dad. Right? So I'll cherish that memory till my last breath, too. Many of you know Dad was a fixer. It may have not always been done right. Or as my friend Drew likes to say, he Levesque'd it. But he always got it working again. The day after Dad left us, Mom and I were pointing out the things Dad had Levesque'd in his recent house projects. And we laughed about it. It wasn't perfect, but to her it was perfect. Let's go down that road for a minute. Dad couldn't sit still. If he wasn't working on the house, he was walking in the woods, looking for deer signs so that he could bag his next buck. Or he was tinkering with something just to get it working again, or he'd be stacking wood for wintertime. Dad was a great helper. Never a great helper. He was a doer. He would come around and see what you were doing and offer you some advice and then very quickly take over the project for you. It's good, though, if you didn't want to do something. Be, Dad, I need some help. Can you help me figure this out? And the next thing you know, he's changing your brakes for you. And Justin and Nate can attest to this. Over the years, Dad made a name for himself in the professional world. He worked at Bath Iron Works for years, starting as a crane operator and ending as a safety engineer. He then took a leap of faith and headed to this newer company in Pittsfield called Somatex. He was hired there to oversee their crane training program. The company's president, Brian, realized how valuable Dad was and ended up promoting him to vice president. He had made enough of a name for himself at that time that people were offering him jobs to go work for them. Some of them came with a pretty great salary, but they would require him to be away from home for extended periods of time. And just Dad just couldn't do that. He could not leave his precious wife or his family for endless weeks without him being there to help us if we needed him. So he eventually went back to Bath Iron Works for a few years, where he was hired as a principal project manager, where it said he improved the overall crane safety program there. Pastor Ron had a great story. There's tons of them. Towards the end of his time at Bath Iron Works, he was promoted to superintendent for cranes and rigging. They had enough trust in him that he could be given a task of moving a 300 to 500 ton unit, knowing that he would get it done safely and efficiently. After 6 or so years, he left the yard and went to Tex-Tech, where he was an environmental safety and health manager. And then Dad retired in 2021. And the real work started then. He had the honey-do list to get done. And he had, even up until the day he headed to camp, he was still working on the house, trying to check things off that list for Mom. Over the years, he made many friends at work. He brought up some people's names so frequently, like Bob Willard and John Stewart that I felt like I knew them personally. Honestly, there's too many names to mention of the people that he talked about, but know that he valued all of your friendships and he spoke very highly of all of you. Dad taught me what a husband should be. He loved my mom so deeply that it was just plain to see. They would argue from time to time, but what married couple doesn't? It was just their passion for love and life bubbling over. They always made up in the end, and that's what mattered. Mom and Dad would often be seen holding hands as they walked through their life. Dad would be seen softly stroking the palm of Mom's hand when they were in church or on a car ride. She says that's one of the things she's probably going to miss the most. Together, there was nothing that they couldn't accomplish or overcome. Mom commented to me the other day that Dad always made her feel so beautiful, even when she didn't agree with him. His love for her could not be overstated. It was so immense that it didn't matter how little the need Mom had, he was there for her. Hunting camp is a little over 2 hours from home. And on this trip, most recent trip, even though he had just gotten to camp 2 days earlier, Mom had called him in a little bit of a panic. The oven, or stove, we debated what it was called. Mom says stove, I say stove, they say oven, doesn't matter. Stopped working, and she was a little bit panicking because how am I going to cook Thanksgiving meal without a stove? What did Dad do? Got in his car, drove the 2 hours home, fixed the stove for Mom, said he loved her, and headed back to hunting camp. 4 hours of driving for a very, very simple fix. And that's what it's all about. To love your wife unconditionally and without bounds. To Dad, her problems were his problems, and they needed to be fixed right now. Dad would do his best to take care of Mom, which at the time was a blessing. But as we transition into this life without him, it gives Mom some hurdles that she needs to overcome. She has a lot of learning ahead of her for dealing with the things that Dad just always did. She lost her husband, her best friend, and her partner. Mom, I promise you that we, your family, your friends, and your children will get you through this. We will hold you up, and we will be there for you no matter what. Dad helped so many people over the years that they want to repay that favor. So please do not be afraid to ask if you need something. We'll do our best to fill the gap that was left after losing Dad. Honestly, I feel like I'm doing a poor job describing Dad's love for Mom. It's like the words just don't exist, how much he cared for her and cherished her. As I've been putting together thoughts of what I wanted to talk about my dad, his hands kept coming into my mind. His hands were pretty beat up. He always had a blister, a scar, a purple fingernail, something. But those hands have seen and done so many things. They signed a marriage certificate with my mother and embraced her hands as they took their vows. They signed off on a mortgage so that our family had a home to grow up in, and then he built that home. They held me when I was only minutes old. They cleaned me up when I was dirty and even changed my diapers. Those hands were a solid thing for me to hold on as I was learning to walk. And then they picked me up when I fell down and pushed me to keep on going. They passed a baseball or a basketball thousands upon thousands of times. They held me as I learned to ride a bike and cleaned up my cuts from falling off. His hands loved me and hugged me more times than I can count. They helped build this church. They signed adoption papers, making our family grow. Those hands held my mother up when her father passed, and he used those hands to caress her cheek as he kissed her. They held onto Mom's hand to show strength in their struggles in life. They held his father's hands after he passed. They held his firstborn grandchild, Gavin, when he was born. And they did the same thing for every grandbaby after that. They built kids' toys, swing sets, and tree houses. They wrote sermons for church. They've just done so much. And when Dad's passed, I held on to his hand tightly, telling him that we were going to be okay as he took his last breath. Dad and Gavin had a special bond. He was the one that promoted my parents to grandparents. I remember the day Gavin was born. He was born by C-section, and I was the one that got to walk him out of the operating room. Did none of the work, got all the glory. I distinctly remember walking out that operating room, and I go through the door, and there's another door ahead of us that has just this little diamond window, and I see Dad throwing elbows with somebody else to try to get that first view, so I'm seeing faces pop in and out of that window. Made me smile. Gavin wasn't the only special one, because Dad loved each and every one of his grandbabies equally. Before Gavin was born, Mom and Dad were trying to figure out what they wanted to be called. Was it Grammy or Grampy? Graham or Gramp? Mom said anything but Grandma because it makes her sound old. Dad didn't really have a preference. Well, Gavin was born, and he learned to talk, and he decided it would be Grandma. And he chose Bumpa for Dad. And that name stuck so well that each and every one of the grandchildren after him, Mason, Aiden, Brooklyn, Wesley, Haley, Camden, and Ryder, have all done the same. Well, Ryder's not talking yet, but you get the point. He was a bumper to them all. For those of you that were able to make it to the visitation yesterday and see the pictures that were playing on the projector, you would often see Dad holding a baby or two. That's who he was. He loved his grandchildren. Pastor Ron had said that being a bumpa was probably his favorite role, and I know that to be a fact. I know it. He was a great dad and an even better grandfather. He made them all feel special in their own way so that they all knew that he loved them. Mom's been adjusting well. There have been plenty of moments filled with peace, followed by moments filled with terror and despair, all of which are very common for the loss of a spouse. She shared a story with me about in the early morning hours of Monday after Dad passed, she was having a moment of deep regret and sorrow. She reached out to her mother and expressed how she was in such pain. For those of you that don't know, Dad made a donation after he passed. His corneas, his bones, and some skin were donated to other people that were in need. Mom was feeling as though she had parted out her husband, and she was having a hard time with that. Graham had the most perfect response to help ease that sorrow. She said, "Listen, Roger will continue to help others. As hard as it is to think of, he has no need for this earthly body. He has a wonderful new one and would want someone to benefit from what he didn't need anymore. Why do we donate things to LACO and the like? Well, it's kind of like that, but on a more magnificent scale. Do you realize how many desperate people he will be helping? And isn't that the very essence of your husband? He never hesitated to help anyone at any time." She went on to say, "He has no need for his earthly garment. And when you meet again, it will be spectacular. God gives us all new bodies, and we don't need two of them. I can understand the gut-wrenching you're going through, but try to think of it as him saving a little one's life, and he was all about the little ones." What a perfect response, right? The reality is, Dad will be helping people, even though he's no longer here. Up to 150 people could benefit from the skin grafts, from children born with cleft lips to burn victims. Dad will be helping them. Countless people will benefit from the donation of his bones. I couldn't even find a number. There's just a lot. And at this time now, two people that could not see can now see again because of Dad. He probably would have been upset that we didn't donate more. He had often joked that he needed nothing after he died and he would be fine if we rolled him up like a sleeping bag when we were done. I'm not kidding, we were just saying that about 2 months ago. Camping was a passion of Dad's. We used to do it all the time when we were younger. We went through quite a progression and regression in our camping lifestyle, though. We started in a pop-up camper, and we moved to a haul-behind trailer, and then into a motorhome. Where do you go from motorhomes? Tents. So we went from living the luxury of a motorhome to being cold and damp in tents. I never fully understood it. But after camping for quite a few years, us kids, we grew up, we moved out, and camping got set on a back burner. And it stayed there for quite a while. Then one random rainy summer, I convinced Mom and Dad to go camping with me at the Northern Pride Lodge in Cacajo. Dad loved the Moosehead area, loved Moosehead Lake. Cacajo's right there. And we camped in a lake. Not on a lake, with a beautiful view, in a lake. It rained a lot that summer. But despite that damp weather, it lit that spark back up for that passion for camping. We started to grow our camping party. So the next year, aunt and uncle came, and then their children came, and then friends came. This past summer, we had 11 families in total with their that came camping with us at Lone Mountain. Dad's love for camping was infectious. His loving and accepting personality was so strong, they became friends with Stephanie and Toby, and they're the ones that own that campground. Many nights, they would just come and sit around the fire with us, and if you listened to Dad talk with them, you would have thought that they were friends forever. They've just known each other for a lifetime. But that's how Dad was. If you knew him, you were a friend or a family member. Thanksgiving came and went between Dad's passing and today, and it was a struggle, to say the least. We battled with whether we would leave his seat open or would we promote somebody to that spot. Dad always sat in the same chair. Dad always said grace. What are we going to do without him? If we set him a place, would we just feel like he's just off on a hunting trip and he was going to be home? The sad reality is that life is forever changed, and not for the better. This will be a year of many firsts and the struggles that go with them. But as our hearts ache and adjust, it gives us peace knowing that Dad is standing in the glory of God. Despite the storm we're in and that we've been facing and not having our captain to guide our little ship, it's important to find hope, that silver lining, something to be thankful for. I've always said that I've been very close to my family, probably annoyingly close. But we've grown closer through this. We really have. In talking with several people over the last week and a half, I've realized that we were beyond fortunate to have such an amazing father. He was a good listener, a good helper, a good sounding board when I need a device, and he was the guy that could fix it all, mostly. I'm thankful to have a father that others wish they had. I'm thankful that the only thing Mom has to worry about are just simple things that we, the friends and family, can help her with. I'm thankful for the amazing, amazing outpouring of support that was shown to my family and my mother during this time. I'm thankful for the stories I was told about Dad yesterday at the visitation. People I didn't know and have never met talked about ways that Dad held them up when they needed, and they could never thank him enough for what they did in his lives. I know Dad was a good dad to me and my siblings, but he was a good father figure to other people that needed it, and it was good to hear those stories. I'm thankful for technology. We have these days that help memories of Dad live on through pictures and videos that are right there at the touch of a finger if we just need to see him or hear his voice. mostly I'm thankful for the love and leadership that he gave to our family. So what do we do now? Where do we go from here? My hand is falling asleep. I'd be remiss to not stand here and touch on Dad's faith for a moment, because he would not miss the opportunity. I know where Dad is today. He's standing before his Lord and Savior in a heaven so great we can't even begin to imagine how awesome it is. We are all sinners. We live our lives in sin. There was a debt that needed to be paid to wash us clean of those sins. And Dad believed down to his very core that Jesus paid that debt for him, that he died on the cross, and in doing so, he washed those sins away for all of us. Dad didn't fear dying because he knew he'd be rejoicing in heaven. And because my father built our home upon that foundation, I know that I will see him again someday. And he will greet us all with a big hug and a kiss on the lips. And he will laugh at the fact that we were down here crying while he was standing up there in paradise. So that's where we go from here, to live the life that Dad would be proud of. I will pass that faith on to my children and eventual grandchildren so that they can have peace when I die, that I will be standing in the glory of God with my Father, waiting for them until they arrive. How awesome. I'm almost done, I promise. I want to take a quick second for some thank yous to each and every one of you that took the time to come here to celebrate my amazing dad's life. Thank you to the Shiloh Church family, to the friends that have brought joy into his life, and to his siblings that picked on him when they were younger and then leaned on him with some of the struggles you had when you were older. Really, I could stand here for an hour giving thank yous to so many people, but just from my family, from my mom, thank you all. My most important thank you goes to Mom. Thank you for picking a man to start our family with that would honor you, take care of us, and love us unconditionally. That is a gift that I will forever be thankful for. One last story. A few days after Dad passed, Mom was sitting in her rocking chair and she was just crying softly. Wesley walked up to her and asked why she was crying. He's 5, he doesn't fully understand what's going on. Mom told Wesley that she missed Bumpa, and he reminded her, but he's in your heart. Mom told Wesley that that was true, but she wanted to hug him. So Wesley did this. He crossed his arms, and he said that because Bumpa was in your heart, you could do this, and you would be hugging him. So if you ever feel like you need a hug from Dad, just take a minute and wrap your arms around yourself and feel his love for you, because he did love you. Okay, I've gone on long enough. I've always thought a quote was a good way to end a speech. For those of you that don't know, my family enjoys Disney. From the movies to going on vacation down in Florida, Disney's kind of a Levesque thing. So my closing quote is this. Goodbye may seem like forever, farewell is like the end, but in my heart is a memory, and there you'll always be. Thank you.
Thank you. That was awesome. That was awesome. Thank you, Andrew, so much. You get to me. And that is your dad's legacy flowing through you, and it's beautiful. So the family has some things to share, and I think that it will add on to what Andrew has shared, because they're also personal, and he has touched all of them in such a way too. So we were discussing earlier about sequence. Not good? You're good. Okay. Erica's coming up first. I don't know if you guys want to come up with her. No. Okay.
Drew has some binder. I have a picture that Mason drew of Encanto characters and a colored pencil that I wrote in. So I will not be as long as Andrew, although that was beautiful, Andrew. Thank you so much. I don't have to introduce myself like Andrew did because I am Dad's favorite, so you all know who I am. I'm good. Wet socks. Wet socks, yes. I am more afraid of public speaking than my mom and I are of things with patterns of holes. And if you don't know what that is, then Google it. It's a real phobia. And I thank all of the donations of flowers, but we're really happy that there were none of those weird, whatever those are. My dad, however, was a great speaker and presenter. His charisma, confidence, and pride in the topic didn't go unseen. When my husband Justin was hired at BIW, Dad was leading the new hire safety training. Justin came home and said how Dad made a relatively boring topic, and I'm sorry if there's any BIW safety people here, really interesting, and how much he had learned. And actually, somebody came through the line last night and also said that they learned more from Dad than anybody else that led a training with a, what are those called? PowerPoint presentation. Dad didn't use those, he didn't need them, and he still kept people interested. I really don't want to be standing here, obviously, because my dad is gone, but honestly, because I'm having a panic attack standing in front of all these people, and I love you guys so much for being here. But I know that my dad would be shocked and so proud of me standing here, and that outweighs my fear. I know he is here, and he's crying, not out of sadness, but out of pride in his daughter and all of us. Or that there's an episode of Dr. Quinn going on in heaven right now. Either way, over the week, there's been a sentence that has come to mind as we have grieved together as a family, and that sentence has been, we'll figure it out. We'll figure it out. As Casey and I were in the car driving, because we took separate vehicles, up north to see Dad, so many things came to mind. And we had to stop and just say, we'll figure it out. And as we said, as we saw Dad and mourned as a family, we stood there and we said, we'll figure it out. Through the days holding on to Mom and loving on her, we said, we'd figure it out. The future, camping, life, my darn broken dryer, Junie's windblown roof, it'll be okay because somehow we're gonna figure it out. But we never had to figure it out. Because we had Dad. He was our lifeline. And he was always there to figure it out. As I was writing my thing on my daughter's little thing here, I also found this little narrative that she was working on in school. And it just seemed, although it's very misspelled, but I will work through this. Dad wrote this, actually. So it says, I went to the movie theater, and I watched Lyle, Lyle, Crocodile. She and I went. And then I cried in the middle of the movie. And then my mom said, it will be okay. And she said, there is always a happy ending. And so through this horrible tragedy that our family is going through, and the pain and the suffering and the loss, we know that Dad had a purpose. And through this, there has to be a purpose. And I just pray and our faith, our family, our blessings, you all here, that his purpose just lives on through everybody. And he loved you all so much. And thank you for being here.
Thank you, Erica. Thank you, thank you. Cassie, Carol, you can come together. And Christopher.
I went to message you today, but I know there will be no reply, for you have taken up to your new home above us in the sky. How do you say goodbye to a legend, our hero? How do I explain with tears in my eyes to my children that this is the end? So many more years we wish to spend, not just a father, but to many a best friend, a husband who adored his wife wholeheartedly and whose family meant the world too. You always were there and accepted whatever challenges life would hand you. True love for the outdoors, fishing pole in hand, or hunting proudly as you walk around God's land. Always there to lend a listening ear or to hold us when we were little and you'd take away our fears. We always knew we were safe because our dad was always near. How do you say goodbye? Truth is, when you left behind so many parts of yourself, Dad. I see you in the faces of all of our friends and family. I feel your embrace around us as we gather around Mom. Dad, you left a legacy behind that you etched in everyone and everything you loved. The walls you built in our family home to the closely knit bond you made that holds this family together. You held us up through the hard times, the good and the bad. No questions in our mind. You were the number one dad. The very best bumpa our kids could ever have. I'm sad, Dad. We're all sad, and this hurts. I'd be lying if I said it didn't hurt so bad. The compassion you had for others is something I will always admire, something that not even the time can expire. I will forever cherish the memories and miss your smile, your hugs. Your love is still here forever in our heart, forever held dear. You may be gone, but you're still here. This is very clear. I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always. As long as I'm living, your baby I'll be.
Beautiful. Thank you. That was beautiful. Carol? Even your name.
I did not plan on speaking today because of the difficulty of the situation, but I am blown away by the love and the outpouring of not just our family and friends, but the community, just people everywhere. The kids have done a really good time. Good job of saying how Roger touched people. You know, I think in the Bible when Jesus was asked, what is the greatest commandment? And he said to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, in that order, I think. But the second one is to love your neighbor as yourself. And Roger did that. He loved the Lord with all his heart, and he loved his neighbors, his family, and he has lived what God has called him to do. And I'm proud. I'm so sad, but my tears are for me and for my kids. I'm not crying for him because when he let go, we knew he was free, and I'm just grateful. So I gotta go backwards here to when Roger's father passed in 2006. I wrote a poem basically about what happens and how everyone rallies around. Like, how sad when there's a funeral with no people at it, because there's something that didn't go right in that. So I wrote this poem for my father-in-law, and Roger read it at his sister Dory's. And I realized when I read this to Pastor Ron the other day that I wrote this poem 16 years ago for my husband. And so I'm going to do my best to read it. And some of you may have heard it before, but it's called What Really Matters. What really matters when push comes to shove is not all the money you have, but the love. It's not about status. It's not what folks say. It's who will be there when you need them someday. Richness is not found in stuff of this life. It's the love of a friend who is there in your strife. When life throws a curve such as illness or loss, what matters is who will be there at all cost. Who'll hug you and hold you or lift up your chin? Who'll do up your laundry or let your dogs in? What matters is who will take hold of your hand in a crisis when you are unable to stand. A friend is the one who'll come quick as a wink, who will come alongside you in times you can't think. So hear this part. So cherish each moment you have while you may, and show those who matter you love them each day. For one never knows when that last beat will come, and there won't be a chance for to do what's undone. For what really matters when life's at its end will be seen in the faces of family and friends. And that's you guys. And that's all the 800 people that we saw last night. So we cry because we're going to miss him. But this poem covers it all. I had people letting in my dogs and folding my laundry. I'm telling you. So we just want to thank everybody, and we just love you all, and I can't thank you enough. Roger was a good example, and I hope people can see that as a positive thing in their lives. Thank you.
Yeah. You didn't see Roger's sister giving you his hug. His hug, she's doing the hug. Thank you. We just have a couple more presentations, and we're going to have a special song, but Vince is a cousin. Vince, where are you? Nephew, were you born in 75? I'm just checking. Roger's nephew.
Hi. all right. So I'm sitting here today struck by, so Roger was the baby. An interesting quick story, because I was the first grandchild. So there's only 13 years. So Roger, for me, has kind of been like a big brother. And I remember stories growing up of something about divorce court with five older sisters and, you know, grandparents, parents coming home just in the nick of time before, you know, they were going to hang him or something. they were just playing, but I won't go on too much, but Roger, as Andrew talked, I can tell you, he would be so proud of the man you've become. It strikes me, I've only ever done this two other times in my life, and both times I've followed your dad. And a great piece of irony, I'm sitting here today following you. And I can't think of a happier thing for him. Erica, you were his favorite. Where are you? As he pointed out, I was firstborn. That's why when I made you eat grass, he didn't beat me up. Casey, he loved you. I'm so proud of all you guys. Carol. I'll tell you, Roger was an important person for my brother and I when my mom got divorced, and I remember he took us on a hike once to nature, and it was amazing. I have a pretty good career today at Bath & Ironworks, and the guy who got me that job was Roger Levesque, you know, and I was just struck by that. So I just, you know, I look at the, he's just always been one of my faves. No offense to my other uncles. But I won't carry on. I'm going to miss him horribly. And I just know how proud he is of all you and how much love he had for everybody. So thanks.
Thank you, thank you. And one more tribute. This is from a close friend of Roger's, known him for many years. James, I don't know where yours, here he comes. And James was up on this final hunting trip with Roger, but they've been prayer partners and buds for a long time. So here you go, James.
A few years ago, Roger received a vision from God. And this vision that Roger received, he saw a man standing like this. And with one hand here, opened up, and marbles went out. And over here he had a hand of marbles that he kept. And I asked the Lord, what did that mean? And right off, he gave me the words of Romans 12:9. And those words are, hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Three days ago, I realized that I was supposed to share that today. So that's the reason I'm up here. The next few verses describe that vision. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn for those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful what to do, what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good.
Thank you, James. Thank you, James. James, you've been a great blessing to many of us. And in teaching us, as Roger taught me many things and shared. We're going to have a special song now, I Can Only Imagine, by Kelly and Carl, if you do that at this time. come up here. Thank you. That was beautiful. Can I have the Shiloh Chapel worship team come up, please? We're going to have one more song in just a minute called Endless Hallelujahs. So a little change of order, Endless Hallelujahs. I thank each and every one of you for sharing. Family, I know it's especially hard for you to do that, but we here feel your heart. And Roger has left such a mark in all of you, not just genetically, but spiritually and every other way. Before we sing this final song, I want to read a couple of verses. And by the way, when James shared from Romans 12, that chapter I studied and actually memorized back when I was in college. But when James was reading it, it was describing Roger so perfectly. It blew me away like it was a whole new passage. But here's something else I want to read, because this is what Scripture says happens to those who die in Christ. And the early Christians didn't understand, as often we don't, what does happen when a person dies. And so the Apostle Paul, I'm going to guess, was given that question, and this is how he answered it. This was to a little church in Thessalonica, Greece, and Paul wrote, "We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who are asleep," that was his metaphor for death, "so that you will not grieve, as indeed the rest of mankind do, who have no hope." When a loved one dies, we wonder what happens. That's not Paul's words, that's mine. But Paul understood, because he knew Jesus had conquered death that first Easter morning and come out of that tomb very much alive, appeared, Scripture says, to over 500 people at one time. He wasn't an apparition. He wasn't just a spirit being. He was the real deal. He was Jesus, back from the dead, fully alive. Because of his resurrection, we have the hope of the resurrection who are in Christ, so we're not without hope. Paul writes, "For if we believe that Jesus died and rose from the dead, so also God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep through Jesus. For we say this to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." Roger's spirit's with the Lord now, but he's going to get a new body, a glorified body, won't bang up his hands fixing things. It's going to be all brand new. "Then we who are alive, who remain, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord." And I would add the words, "and each other." "Therefore, comfort one another with these words." But after Roger passed, I was a quiet time or whatever, and the words came to me, Jesus' words from Matthew chapter 11. And years ago, my first church that I pastored in New Hampshire, we had a few of these words on the sign there, and I've forgotten all about that. It came very quickly and very suddenly. And this was Jesus' promise to those people that were listening then that is true for us today, where Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And what came to me was this: Roger found rest in Jesus. Not just a sleepy kind of rest, but the internal peace that only Jesus can give. And knowing Roger's heart, I think as well as I do, he would say, maybe, not my words, but his, "You can find rest in Jesus too." Now, my words. Actually, you will not find this kind of rest anywhere else. Only Jesus can save you from your sins. Only Jesus offers you eternal life. The life Roger is experiencing right now, his spirit in the presence of the Lord. If you miss the memo, Roger loved people. Roger loved you. If he knew you, he loved you. He prayed for you. And many of you have testified already to this. He spent time with you. He talked to you. He was honest with you. Well, Jesus loves people. Jesus loves you. And you can come to Jesus right now, quietly, in your seat, and invite Jesus to be the Savior, the giver of peace into your life, into your heart. That's what Roger did many years ago. And then he grew in his faith as he grew in Christ's grace. And so we want to sing a closing song before I do a final prayer, celebrating what Roger's, we can't even imagine it, like the song said. We can't even imagine it. It's a very powerful song, and thank you for sharing that with us. But this one expresses a little bit, too, about the worship that's coming and that we can at least get a glimpse of here and now. Thank you, Rick. It's called Endless Hallelujah. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Stand before your throne, dressed in glory not my own. What a joy I'll sing of on that day. No more tears or broken dreams, forgotten is the minor key. Everything as it was meant to be. And we will worship. Forever in your presence, we will sing. We will worship, worship you. An endless hallelujah to the King. I will love you with unsinning heart. See how much you gave to bring me home. Not till then, Lord, shall I know. Not till then how much I owe. Everything I am before your throne. And we will worship. We will sing, we will worship, worship you, an endless hallelujah to the King. No more tears, no more shame, no more sin and sorrow.
With us, please. You probably can figure out the chorus.
And we will worship, worship forever in your presence. We will sing, and we will worship, worship you, an endless house.
Hallelujah. We worship the God who reached out in love and touched Roger. And look what's happened as God touched him and touched his family. And it keeps going and going and going. The legacy of Roger Levesque very much lives on because of Christ in his heart and how he passed that on. Lord, as I pray this closing prayer, our hearts ache for this family. He was a good friend. Roger was a solid friend. I think those are rare. I pray for his sisters. They feel it. It's out of order to lose your baby brother. It just is. For Debbie, Lynn, Luann, Patty, their families. They miss him. They're going to miss him. But Lord, you are the God of all comfort. I didn't make that up. Paul was absolutely right in penning those words, and they've passed on now these 2,000 years very powerfully. You are the God of all comfort. Comfort them, I pray. I pray for his family. The beautiful tributes they've given us today from their hearts. Being in their home together and both feeling their pain and hearing their laughter, Lord. It's so hard, but I'm so glad for their closeness and that they have each other. For Casey and Andrew and Erica and Cassie and Christopher, their spouses, their kids. Oh, Jesus. We love them, but not as much as you love them. Give them your love right now. And of course, we especially lift up Carol for your comfort for her. She said to me and to others, the days aren't so bad, but mornings and nights are really rough. Lord, at those times, let her feel your presence in a very powerful way, in a very tangible way. Remind her of how much you love her and how much all of us love her. Her beautiful family is there with her and supporting her. Be the God of comfort for her right in those moments she needs it most. And Lord, by faith, we commit his earthly remains. They'll be back to the elements as part of your design, but his spirit into your eternal keeping, because we are looking forward to that great resurrection morning. No more sin, no more sickness, no more separation, everything restored. Everyone reunited, all because of you, Jesus. You were and are Roger's Lord and Savior. And you are now, for whoever will come, you can be our Lord and Savior. Paul would write these words as a blessing as we close. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us, and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. To the King of ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. And all God's people said, amen. So you will be dismissed. Do you want to meet people that can't make it to Shiloh? How do you want to do it? Yeah. Why don't we let the family go out first? Sit tight. They'll go out. And then if you're not able to make it over to the luncheon, then please, they want to see you and thank you. Thank you for coming. Okay. On the chorus. Yep.